Good morning, family of God, and good morning, friends. I am so glad you've decided to join us here for worship at Lexington Park Baptist Church. As we prepare our hearts now, let's go ahead and pray, and then we're going to go into our song, our opening song. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this day. We thank you for an opportunity to praise your name. We thank you for yet another opportunity to use this great technology to reach into the homes and to worship together as the people of God. We also thank you that we can go and reach people in other states and even other nations as a result of this technology. Lord, I thank you now that we can worship your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Take it away, Gentle Ben.
Earth is filled. glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory.
Good morning again, everyone. This is our official time, if you will, of greeting. And how we do that is, if you can please go down into the thread on Facebook or on YouTube and just write in there, Macombs 5, your name and how many are joining with us today. If you haven't already checked in, let us know that you're with us. Also, there's a guest form down below. If you can take time, sometime between now and the end of service, go to that website link and please sign in if you're our guest today. Let us know who you are, where you're from. We would love to send you an email and thank you for joining us for our digital worship. Again, I hope everyone that's joining us today will be blessed because they've come here. Let's pray. Father God, we lift up your holy name. We're excited to worship you, and we are so honored to gather together as your people. May you bless these praises. May you inhabit these praises. May you be enthroned on these praises as we praise your holy name. And Lord, may you bless your people because we have been found faithful during this COVID-19. And may we be found faithful as we come back. And God, may you guide the leadership of this church as we make decisions. And Father God, may you bless each home and each person that's praising you and worshiping you this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, thank you for joining us. Going to go into some announcements. Some of the announcements have changed. I know we kind of been the same, but I want to emphasize Go 2020. Gospel opportunity, gospel obligation. We have studied already from Matthew 24. Part of the return of Jesus Christ is our obligation to share the gospel to the ends of the world. Digitally, that's one way we can do it right now. But it's your obligation. It's my obligation. It's our opportunity. It's my opportunity to share the gospel with someone. So I want to share something with you. I was able to share the gospel with someone. Actually goes all the way back to March 15th. There was a person in our midst that came here on that Sunday, actually March 22nd. And on March 22nd, they gave their life to Jesus, and I got to follow up with him throughout this COVID-19. And we have a new believer in Jesus Christ is going to be baptized. That's what we do. We communicate with people that we know, our friends, our coworkers, our family, take the opportunity, maybe share them, send them a gospel presentation, or maybe a short video or something from Billy Graham. Use the technology tools that we have. Share the gospel with someone. Say, hey, this is really important to me, and I want to share it with you. Go 2020. That is something we're going to do for the rest of the year. When we get back, as we come back, and also digitally, go 2020. Share that word of encouragement with PC Studios, with Pastor Chris McCombs, every weekday at noon. We're going to continue this. This is something that I'm committed to bring you a message of encouragement, to bring you your pastor's heart, to bring you something from the Word of God, weekdays at noon. Join us for Word of Encouragement. Also, moving through the week, while now we're in our summer break, we will not have Wednesday worships, but we still will have our digital community groups. Now, there may be some transitions that will happen during the summer, but right now, phase one, we stay with our community digital groups that meet on Mondays at 7 p.m. Please contact Pastor Joe Fessler about that. He'll give you guidance, but we're trying to move towards remaining in the home. And if we do come back, we'll move more towards a home group mentality, continuing these community groups until we can figure out what we're going to do strategically coming into the fall. So be looking for more information. That could change some, but continue the digital community groups. Contact Pastor Joe Fessler if you have any questions about that. And then tonight, I'm excited to promote to you, May 31st is finally here. A lot of work has gone into this, some planning and praying and processing. We are going to have outdoor worship. Woo! We're going to get to go outside and finally get to be together in the assembly, not digitally, but in the physical assembly and proximity right here together at Lexington Park Baptist Church tonight at 7 p.m. Join me on the front yard. That's actually right behind me where the big cross is out front and the signs are. You're going to park in the parking lot wings, and then you'll come in, and you will sit in the parking lot and in the grass areas all the way over to the magnolia tree, which for me is on this side of the building, and also on this side, which is Willows Road, there's some grass area too. And then there's the grass area by the road. So we're going to encourage you to come. Bring your lawn chair. We are going to ask you to bring a bottle of water because it's not going to be too hot, but bring a bottle of water. And also consider, please bring your mask and be considerate of others. So we're not going to have to wear the mask the whole time, but when we interact with each other, we're going to ask that out of respect for one another, we wear the mask. Listen to your pastor. I don't want to wear a mask either, but from my heart, I'm asking you to do this, okay? When we sing, so that we control that, and we're going to do social distancing. So if you come to worship tonight, those are kind of like we're asking you, please don't put you in a position where you're in defiance with your pastor. So if you can't comply with those things, I ask you, then you're not ready to come back to worship physically yet. I'm sorry. But that's my heart to you. I ask you to do that. I ask you to honor that. But let's get excited. We can come back. We can worship our God. We can sing praises to our God. We have several hymns picked. We have some great worship music picked out. I'm going to preach on the church has left the building and what it means to be renewed. So come and let's start to begin this revival in our midst. The church has left the building. Summer services are going to happen all summer long outside in the front yard of our church. I'm excited. This is a new movement of God, and I think God's got his hand on this, and let's see what God can do with us. Also, there's one other thing that's going on this evening. As you know, we're worshiping at 7, but at 6 p.m., Grills for Glory. You can see the sign up here, Grills for Glory. If you would like to come and do tailgate, you do need to practice social distancing during your tailgate, but families, obviously, you guys are together. But we can still come together. If you want to do a tailgate, we're going to do that down. You need to park on the parking lot down by the grass side, all right? And you can put your grills down there. You can spread your cars out. You can use the yard down there, whatever you want to do. But we come Grills for Glory. So if you'd like to do that, please join us. We're going to open that up. And if it takes off, hey, this summer, you know, maybe you have some cornhole competitions, and who knows where this can go. But starting tonight at 6, if you would like to, Grills for Glory. I hope to see you here at 6 p.m. for Grills for Glory, and I hope to see you here for 7 p.m. for our outdoor worship summer series, The Church Has Left the Building, Revival in Our Midst. The only other announcement I want you to know is that we are praying. And so what I'm going to ask you to do this week, coming up, pick one day to pray and to fast. Give something up. Pray, you know, from sun up to sundown, give up food. Give up your coffee, whatever it is. Give up your chocolate. Give something up and give it to the Lord and focus on praying for this one thing. Lord, what's the comeback supposed to look like for Lexington Park Baptist Church? And Lord, give the church leadership the wisdom to make this decision. That's it. God, what's the comeback supposed to look like for our church? And give the church leadership. And when you do that, let it go. Trust your church leadership then from that point. You know, as we pray this thing through, as we look this thing through, as we start to come back, we will eventually come back in the building. What's that going to look like? How we're going to do it? And it's going to happen. And I'm excited about it. But right now we have outdoor and we have digital worship, but we're praying about that. So can you this week, this is my announcement to you, can you pray and can you fast?
Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe through every blessing, through every promise, through every protector, you are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you, and you meet me in it, ain't mercies that I knew. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to,
the light. I Wonderful.
It is always good to share good news. As we come to giving time, it's our time to where we honor the Lord with our time, our talents, and our treasures. And during this, you all have done amazing in giving your treasures. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for your cheerfulness. And thank you for your adaptability to give digitally. And listen, thank you for your faithfulness. So I stand before you again. We are on target, 98% on target for our budget. We praise God that the PPP dollars came through, the payroll protection plan, so we can pay our teachers, continue to pay our staff, even though the church is online. Remember, tuition was lost, so we just praise God for his many provisions. Thank you for what you've done. Again, 98% on track. Let's keep it up. Good job, family of God. And may the Lord bless us as we're confound faithful to his giving. Listen to the word of the Lord. In Genesis 14, Abram has gone out to a battle, and he's coming back, and he runs into Melchizedek. And listen to what happens in 14, verse 18. Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was a priest of the God Most High. He blessed Abram, and he said, Abram is blessed by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has handed over your enemies to you. And then Abram gave him a tenth of everything, gave an offering unto the Lord. May we give the Lord a tenth of our offerings always, and even above giving into our, not only our tithe, but our offerings and our gifts and our generosity and our cheerfulness, in which we can give what God's laid on our hearts to give. So continue to give. You can see the link below. It's an opportunity. You can give right now. You can write it down. You can give later. Continue to follow whatever you're doing, whether you're mailing in your checks or whether you're doing it digitally. I just thank you for your faithfulness. Let's continue to give to the Lord. And may the Lord, just like he blessed Abram, may he bless Lexington Park Baptist Church. May he bless you. Father God, we thank you that we can come before you and give you our tithes and offerings. Thank you for the faithfulness of your people. Thank you for the example of Melchizedek and Abram, and how Abram came and was blessed. And then Abram gave a tenth in honor of you, Lord. May we give you back what you have blessed us with. May we give out of the abundance and even beyond. And Lord, may we give faithfully to the operating budget, but also faithfully to the COVID-19 and benevolence offerings that we have and other mission efforts that may come up. Lord, we thank you for blessing your people, and we thank you for your provisions. We ask you now to take these gifts, take these tithes, take these offerings, Lord. Use them to expand your kingdom and to continue the work of this church at Lexington Park Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Morning. You know, whether it is doors or many miles apart, I'm so thankful for the technology that we have during this time. You know, the church has left the building, but we're still together, and that's a wonderful thing. My dad and I wanted to put a little song together for you guys. This is a song that he wrote a while ago. I grew up listening to it as a little girl. It's actually a poem that he put music to. It was my favorite and my great-grandmother's favorite growing up, so I hope you enjoy it, too.
Good evening from Kentucky. It's good to be with you, even though it's by video. I'm glad to share this song with my daughter, whom I love very much, and I miss her and her family so much during this time. I'm sure it's been difficult on everyone. You know, we have an obligation to pray for each other, and we should do that. This song is called I Said a Prayer for You Today. God bless you. I said a prayer for you today, and I know that God must have. I felt the answer in my heart, although he
I didn't ask for wealth or fame. I knew I ask him to send treasures of a far more lasting kind, yeah. I ask him to be near you at the start of each new day, to grant you health and blessings and friends to share your way. You see, my brother, I said a prayer for you today. I ask him to be near you at the start of each new day, to grant you health and blessing and friends to share your way. You see, my sister, I said a prayer for you. I said a prayer for you today.
God bless you. Love you, Ashley.
Heavenly Father, we come before you with humility and with grace, with mercy and a plea for patience. Lord, we pray for your people that in this time of comeback, in this time that we've just gone through over several months of what will forever be known as COVID-19 and the coronavirus, Lord, not knowing the future, but being in the midst of this right now, we just pray that as we come back, that the church can come back unified. Lord, we pray that we will lay down any petty differences or personal agendas or divisive attitudes that we may have. Lord, may we repent of those things. May we genuinely unite behind your gospel, behind the outpouring of your Spirit to lead us to revival. Father God, throughout this whole thing, as the pastor of Lexington Park Baptist Church, I have tried to be an example to the people of God. Lord, I pray that the spirit of cooperativeness will be upon all of us, that through this time, that if we have missed the opportunity that you have brought us for renewal, that we will repent of that. If we've been so caught up in criticism and complaining and questioning and in our rights and in defiance and in our differences, God, may we rebuke that right now in the name of Jesus Christ. There's no place of that amongst the brethren. And Lord, even though we may have different opinions, may we not let that bring us to a place disunity. God, I pray right now, just as you wrote to Ephesians, that you will bring us to walk in a manner that is worthy of the calling that you have called us to, that we will do so with all humility, all gentleness, and in patience we will bear with one another in love, and we will eagerly pursue the unity of the Spirit, which brings a bond of peace. This is what Paul wrote in Ephesians 4:13. Lord, may we live those words out now. So as we move to come back, as we move tonight to worship May 31st outside 7 p.m. for outdoor worship, I am so excited, God. I know the people of God should be excited. Yeah, we still have social distancing. Yes, we still have masks. Yes, we still have lawn chairs. Yes, we're going to have to do a lot of things and be creative. And a lot of people are going to have to do extra things that aren't normal. But I pray it will be a unifying movement for our church. And Lord, as we look to come back to the facility, may we never forget we are not a building. We are the church. We never closed. We don't have to reopen because we have always been your church. So Lord, my heart is just for renewal. Lord, may we be renewed. And if we've missed this opportunity you've given us as an opportunity to seek renewal, to be in your word, to pray, to connect with our families, to draw closer to you, and to be more ready to come back to know what really is essential and what is so, so important to us in life. If we've missed that, God, may in these final moments, what appears to be a final moment before we transition to the comeback, may each person seek you. Humble ourselves. Get rid of our pettiness. Get rid of our pride. Get on our face. Say, God, I'm sorry if I missed it. If I was more focused on the virus, being critical of it, or saying how stupid this was, or if I was more focused on the virus and being fearful of it, may we in these final moments take the time to repent of that. Each person right now. Renew us, God. I know without the renewal, the revival that we pray for will never happen. So may each person be renewed in their mind, in their hearts, in their souls. May they be closer to you now than when this first thing started. And Father, may we come back now with a renewed spirit that's focused on the eternal church of Jesus Christ. And may we come back with a passion to see revival, God, to seek you in our midst, to be a people that have been revived, and then, God, out of that, we pray for an awakening amongst the nations. God, I prayed for that throughout this whole thing. It didn't happen. People focused more on the virus instead of you, and that even happened in the church. So, God, I pray somehow renewal, revival, and awakening can be possible. So in this moment, Lord, may we put aside our differences, our agendas, and our divisive attitudes, and may we seek genuinely, wholeheartedly, to unite behind your movement, your revival, your awakening, your purposes, and may we rise up and be your church. I pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And with one voice, may all of God's people say, Amen. Everybody get out their Bibles and raise them high and say this with me. This is my Bible, God's holy word. I'll make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path and hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Amen and God bless you. Today we continue our sermon series called Prepared from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24. Isn't it awesome how God works things? Over a year ago, he laid out the plans that I would preach for this year. And prepared the end times sermon series that I'm preaching right now. He knew I didn't know, but he knew COVID-19 would happen. He knew during this digital worship time that we would be preaching on this final discourse from the Gospel of Matthew. And I just think it's awesome how God does those type of things. And today I'm excited because today is prepared for Jesus to crack the sky. We finally get to start to talk about the actual return. Jesus' return, cracking the sky, perhaps a prelude or a vision of what the rapture will be like. Jesus, remember, is not, I don't look at Matthew 24 as chronological. I look at more as Jesus teaching a bird's eye view of the end times and how things are going to play out. Eschatological history, how the study of end times, how history is going to play out, the repetitiveness, the repeatingness of signs and persecution and all the things we've been preaching on, the proclamation of the gospel. And now here we're getting to finally where, you know, the birthing pains, the labor pains, and then bam, we talked last week about the great tribulation. And so that's why I don't think it's chronological. And now we're going to talk about this rapture. So Jesus is painting a picture of all the things that will happen. And so whether this is the second coming, like as in the rapture, or the glorious appearing, or the reign of Christ, however this plays out, and again, somebody said we're pantheists, right? It all pans out in the end. But I'm going to teach, I really believe, I've been taught and believe that a pre-tribulational, premillennial view of scriptures is accurate. So I think we have to look at Daniel, we have to look at Revelation, and we have to look at it as Jesus is unfolding this and telling this to us to have the full understanding. But Jesus has given us all the nuts and bolts. And so right here, he's talking about cracking the sky. He's talking about coming back and what that's going to be like. So I'm excited to start to talk about, as we move through this, now we're finally at that moment where Jesus is going to start the second coming process. And I look at the second coming advent, just like the first advent. It just didn't happen like that. He came, he lived, he died, he breathed, he did his ministry, and then he was risen from the dead and he ascended. The second coming's like that. The rapture, the glorious appearing, the great tribulation is between that, and then we get to the millennial reign, and then we get to the finale where all things are consummated, all judgments are done, and we go into the new heaven, the new earth, and the new Jerusalem. That's my view of eschatology. So in a nutshell. So that's where we're going, and that's how I'm viewing Jesus' discourse with the disciples. Now, did they have all this? No, they hadn't written it. The apostles, the disciples that were going to write, you know, John's book of Revelation wasn't written yet. You know, the Gospel of Matthew wasn't written yet as this discourse is going on. So the Bible came to emerge as they started to write these things down, and Paul starts to write things, and pictures become clearer about the end times as we put it all together and we look at the bird's eye view. But Jesus, in one shot, right here in 24 and 25 of Matthew, in this discourse, is giving us a good picture of what it's going to be like. So, the second coming will not be hidden. It's not just for a select few. It is going to be like lightning across the sky. He's going to crack the sky. That's what we need to see today. That's what we need to understand. The point needs to be clear. We will know when Jesus returns. So if you've ever wondered, how will I know? You will know. Jesus is saying it's like lightning that cracks the sky from the east to the west. So when we get to that part, I'm excited to preach on that part of this text today. It's going to be known to us. So as we read this, remember, you will know. And if you're a Christian, you know, what's it going to be like to jump and be raptured and taken up into the sky and go back with Jesus and then come back with him on his glorious appearing? I don't know, but it's going to be awesome. It's going to be amazing. And Jesus is describing it now as cracking the sky. You will know, it's going to be apparent. So let's read the word of the Lord. Let's look at the Gospel of Matthew 24, starting in verse 23, and we'll go through 31. If anyone tells you then, see, here is the Messiah, or over here, do not believe it, for false messiahs and false prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, even the elect. Take note, I have told you in advance. So if they tell you, see, he's in the wilderness, don't go. Or see, here, he's here in the storerooms, do not believe it. For as the lightning comes from the east and flashes as far as to the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man. Wherever a carcass is, the vultures will gather. Immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened. The moon will not shed its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heavens will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. And then all the peoples of earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. He will send out his angels with a loud trumpet, and there he will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky and to the other. May God add a blessing to his holy word. As we look at this text, may we see that Jesus is going over again something that he said several times. He's talked to us about false messiahs, and he's talked to us about false prophets. He opens this section of this discourse once again, the third time. He warned us signs of his return would be what? There will be false prophets, false messiahs. Then we get to the persecution. Hey, there's going to be falseness. There's going to be false prophets. There's going to be false teachings. There's going to be false messiahs. They're going to emerge. And now, once again, when we get to the final thing, the final aspect, he's warning us this whole time throughout history, eschatology. He's telling us, see the Messiah. False messiahs, false prophets, imposters will rise up. They will come to deceive. Now, in this case, listen, this is really important. Not only has Jesus told us there are signs, it's part of the persecution, and now it's part of the actual final aspect of my return. He's letting us know that even the elect, if possible, will be deceived. Now, what's that mean? Even the elect is us. Anyone that belongs to the Lord, that is saved, that has been regenerated, that has been reborn, you are the elect. So if you're out there and you're a Christian, truly someone that's given their life to Jesus, believes in his death, burial, and resurrection, and believes he's the Lord of lords and King of kings, and you have professed him and confessed him over your life, you're the elect. Jesus is saying it's even going to be possible for the elect to be deceived by these imposters. So there are going to be not carnal Christians, but sincere Christians that think sincerely about the Lord that can be deceived. So why is Jesus telling us this? So we're aware. So I'm talking to you, the elect. We must be aware. Look right there in verse 25. The great signs, the wonders, and all, they may be led astray. Jesus says, take note, I have told you in advance. He's telling his apostles, the disciples, and he's telling us as his disciples in the 21st century, take note of this in advance. No, be prepared. There may be imposters out there. Listen, there are going to be people that say they speak for me, but they don't speak for me. There's going to be people out there that are going to prophesy things that are going to be against my word. They're going to be against my gospel. It may tickle your ears. It may seem good. It may seem real. You may hear of them being out in the wilderness. You may be tempted to go and say, I got to see these signs and wonders and what's going on. Hey, or I may hear he's in storerooms, or he's in churches, or he's in these places, or he's in this arena, or he's on this TV, a televangelist. I need to go see this. And Jesus is saying, don't go there. You'll know when it's me. That's not me. If they're claiming to be a false, if they're claiming to be a Messiah, it's false. I'm the real deal. So take note. Jesus is telling us, take note. They will not be. Do not go there. You will know when I have come. In 1 John 4:1, he says, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets has gone out into the world. So John is telling us in a book that he wrote from 1 John, he's saying, hey, these false prophets, this is a real deal. They've gone out into the world. Jesus told them back here in Matthew 24, he remembers this. And he's telling us we have to test these spirits. Don't go out to anything, these wonders and signs and all these things and get caught up in this stuff and follow false teachings and false prophets, but specifically these false messiahs that are claiming to be the Messiah. The Antichrist ultimately will try to take the Messiah's place, try to take the place of God. So we have to prepare ourselves now to know and see the signs of that happening, and so we can know when Jesus really comes back. In Matthew 7:15 through 20, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Verse 17, so every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Skip over to verse 20. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. How do we know a false prophet? How do we know a false Messiah? How do we know a false teaching? How do we know false teachers? All these things. How do we know? We test the spirits, comparing them to God, and we look at their fruit. A bad tree cannot produce good fruit. It's impossible. So a diseased tree cannot become healthy. So we've got to, Jesus is telling us these things. So we're looking at the fruit of the ministry. We're looking at the fruit of the pastor. But this is even on a bigger picture. We're looking at the fruit of someone that may claim, that may do signs and wonders, and may claim to be the Messiah. We have to be aware. Not only are there going to be wolves among us, and the wolves among us, Jesus is warning us so that we can be prepared, I think, for the big show when the false messiahs come. And Jesus is saying they're always going to be there. You need to be looking for the wolves, but you need to be looking for these false messiahs that will come. In 2 Corinthians 11:14, even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. Look, I don't know what part in Revelation we hear about the Antichrist, and I don't know if this, say this was the final one, the final labor pains. I'm not saying that we are, but say we were. The Antichrist would have to emerge sometime during that period to usher in the Great Tribulation. Could he be here now? He could be. If this is the finale, he would be here somewhere. He may not have emerged yet. He may not call himself. He may not, listen, he's not just going to come out and say, hey, I'm the Antichrist. Hey, I'm the false Messiah. No, he's going to try to take the place of the Messiah, and he's going to do signs and wonders, and he's going to use the words of Satan, which, listen to what Satan does. He takes the word of God, and he craftily and cunningly twists it in such a way to deceive people. And listen, if Satan could deceive Eve, who are we to think he could not even deceive us? So God is warning us, and Jesus is warning us, take note. Deception is real. So Christian in the 21st century, we need to be aware of deception. We need to be aware of Satan's tactics to distract us. Listen, if he can distract us right now during COVID-19 to not focus on renewal, to not focus on revival, to not focus on awakening, but we're so focused on the virus, either being in defiance to it or living in fear of it. Yeah, let me say that again. Either living in defiance to all the stuff, or either living in fear of it, we've lost focus on Christ. No, you've not followed a false Messiah, but you followed a deceptive tactic of the devil. Yes, I just said that. So Jesus is warning us to take note. Keep your focus on me. Can we do that, Church of Jesus Christ? Keep your eyes looking to the sky. Look for what's to come, the crack of the sky. Look for my return. Look for my right teachings. Be in the Word. Be in prayer. Be about my gospel and not chase squirrels. Squirrel! God doesn't want us to do that. He's created us to keep our focus on Him, to worship Him and Him alone. May we do that. May we be prepared, because deception of the Antichrist will be great. Deception and the works of Satan, they go all the way back to the Garden of Eden, you guys. They've not stopped. God, even Satan tried to deceive Jesus in the wilderness. How did Jesus overcome Satan? With the Word of God. By not twisting it, by speaking it, by knowing it, by living it, being able to discern the deception of false teachings and false prophets and false doctrines and false messiahs. Jesus is the Messiah. May we never forget that, and may we always look to Him. Now we get to the return. We get to the rapture. This is exciting. This is where we get the jump and we don't come back down. And we get the jump and not come back down. Wouldn't that be awesome? We will defy gravity. If you want to live in defiance, let's defy gravity someday with this rapture. Listen to what Jesus says here. The visible to all. Cracking the sky will be visible to all. I grew up in the 80s when I got saved, and Mylon LeVever and the Broken Heart was a rock band that was out then, and they have a song called Crack the Sky. It influenced me. It influenced my theology. Jesus, crack the sky for me. Take me home. I'm ready to go. Crack the sky for me. And this is the exact words Jesus has used here. He will crack the sky like lightning is from the east and shoots all the way to the west. So from horizon to horizon, Jesus is saying he's going to crack the sky. You're going to see it. You're going to know it. There's going to be no doubt about it. Jesus, the rapture will be known to all. Now listen, here's what's going to happen. If we're raptured, we're going to know. We're going to be gone. When Jesus cracks that sky instantly and takes us up to be with him, it'll be known, right? So when that happens, people that are left behind, they're going to know something's happened. But they're going to be, listen, they will be either ignorant to it or they will ignore it. And if you've ever read the Left Behind series, you can see how that plays out. They come up with all kinds of reasons or excuses of what happened to all these people. What happened? They're either ignorant to it or they'll ignore it, and then the Antichrist will come in and will bring deception. There will be deception. There'll be false messiahs that will emerge then too that will deceive even those that will become tribulational saints or tribulational believers and the 144,000 witnesses that you can read in Revelation. There's a chance that there's going to be deception going on at the same time truth is being spoken, and then the Antichrist will rule, and it's not going to be pleasant. But up to that point, when this happens, that's not been established. There may be movements going that way, but the cracking of the sky, this is part of the second coming. Again, the rapture of Jesus will turn like a flash of the sky across the sky. Jesus will take us home. Are you ready? I'm ready. Are you looking for the cracking of the sky? Are you ready to jump and your feet not come back down? Won't that be a glorious thing to be a part of the rapture? I pray it happens in our generation. I would love, could you imagine to be the generation that never experiences physical death, but just simply experiences an immediate bodily transformation and is raptured up into the fullness and the presence of Jesus Christ? Wow. Like the flashing of lightning across the sky. Boom, Jesus cracked the sky. So I started pondering on this. I mentioned a little bit about it. It got me thinking, you know, because we're in the midst of this COVID-19 thing. And I'm asking you to pray and fast because I want us to, as we come back, we need to come back for Jesus. We don't need to come back just simply because we can clean the sanctuary correctly. We don't need to come back because we just think this is all stupid. By the way, I don't agree with that. We don't need to delay coming back either because we're scared or we're afraid. So we've got to come back for the right reason. And what's the right reason? Listen to me, congregation. Jesus. He is the one that needs to say, come back inside. And until we have all our confusion, the things that are distracting us, all the squirrels that we're following, conspiracies and fear and doubts and all this other stuff, whatever everybody's been chasing around, until we can come together and say, my focus is on Jesus Christ, and we return for him. We come back for him. And we are ready to move forward with him. That's where we need to be, not caught up in anything else. I think this pandemic has given the world an opportunity. Maybe even an example of, again, for Christians, will we be focused on Jesus? Because I'm telling you, a lot of us took our focus off of him. I had to keep making sure my focus was on him. Making sure we're not just caught up on a virus, but we're caught up on Jesus Christ. That we're looking for him to crack the sky, that we're looking for his return. Now listen, the coronavirus didn't usher in the return of Jesus Christ. There were people that were claiming that too. You know, could this be the beginning of some birth pains? Is it part of these viruses and these bad things that Jesus spoke about? Obviously, Jesus talked about that, right? Famines, diseases, all these things that will take place over history, yes. Is it part of that? Yes. Is it the one that brings it in? I don't know. But governments have been consumed. Medical industries have been overwhelmed. Supply chains have been overwhelmed. We have seen people in a panic. We have seen commerce that's been halted. We have seen economies that have faltered, that have been in ruin. We have seen Satan blamed to take the glory from Jesus. We've seen conspiracies forecasted. But I've heard very little talk of let's be focused on Jesus. Let's be focused on Jesus. Jesus is telling us, and something we can walk away from Matthew 24, is that no matter what goes on around us in our world, the signs and the persecution, even getting to this point, until you see that sign, until you see the sky crack, be focused on me. His return. He will crack the sky. He will take us home. We will be raptured. Glory to God. But let's not get confused in the other things that take place. Let's make sure that our focus is what Jesus talked about in the proclamation, expanding the gospel to the ends of the world. That is our job. That's our obligation. Now, we need to live in the reality of things that are going on. And I think that Christianity and science and Christianity and medicine and Christianity and all and government and everything should be able to work together for the glory of God. But the church is the entity of Jesus Christ that is his bride. We are the ones looking for his return. And we are the ones that are declaring the good news to the nations. That's you and me. We look for his return. The bride, we are ready. We take the gospel to the ends of the world. We take it to the government. We take it to the science. We take it to the medicine. Not them taking it to us. Can I get an amen? We take the gospel. We represent Christ. We are his bride. Ready for his return. Listen to what Jesus goes on to say in verse 28. Vultures and eagles, depending upon your translation. Listen, you ever seen something die? What happens? The birds soar. The vultures soar. Jesus is saying, soaring over prey. You will know it has happened. Just like you see those, you know when you see those vultures circling, you know something's dead there. Jesus is saying, you know, you will know. Just like that's a sign, you will know I have returned. His return will be obvious. In verses 29, we see Jesus use the word distress again. So the great distress or tribulation we just preached on last week. But here in verse 29, he's referring back to verse 21. He's saying the distress of those days will be so great that they will have never been seen. And that's talking about the great tribulation. But Jesus here is literally, in this verse, he's referring back to it. He's telling us, not chronologically, but the distress will be great. He's referring that during this time, after the cracking of the sky, that this distress will be the distress I just told you about. It's going to happen. It's going to come. It's going to be here. He's reminding us over and over about the events that will play out that will lead to the cracking of the sky, that will lead to this great tribulation, and then ultimately will lead to his glorious appearing and eventually someday his reign here on earth. Jesus also speaks in verse 29 of the powers of heaven will be shaken. Jesus is using apocalyptic language that sometimes the prophets of old used, especially like Joel, right? Joel preaches that, and then we see that in Acts chapter 2 come out. But what we see here, Jesus is definitely speaking in his return in apocalyptic terms like the sun and the moon and the stars and the skies and all of the heavens. In other words, the cracking of the sky and all these other things, the sun, the moon, the stars, all these things are going to play out, and it's my return. It's me coming back. Whether it's literal or figurative, because scholars are all over the place on this, it appears to be literal to me. No matter what they are, though, they are earth-shattering. They will get our attention. Now, will we see it? And let me give you an example. If someone goes and goes to this beautiful place on earth and all of creation around them and they can see the stars and the skies and they're sitting there and they're not a believer, right? And then I go to that same place and I'm seeing all the beauty of these mountains and these landscapes and the beautiful stars and I'm sitting there, I'm going to say in my heart, wow, God created that. Look how big and great our God is. But that non-believer is going to be sitting over there. They're not going to say that. They're not going to see. They're seeing the same thing I'm seeing, but they miss God. But I am there seeing the same thing, and I see God. Some people will not see. All these amazing things will happen. The cracking of the sky, the rapture, all the sun, the moon, and the stars, and all these things that Jesus is talking about that's going to unfold. It will be earth-shattering, literally, to get our attention. Some people just won't see it. Some people won't get it. Some people will notice it and see it and be aware and say, that's it. And others will miss it. We need to make sure we're on the side that sees the signs coming and unfolding. And then we're looking for the cracking of the sky and the signs and the sun and the moon and the stars. It will be earth shattering. Get this. The first advent. The first. Listen. Parousia is the first time is used here in the coming. And it's a word for advent. It's kind of like advent. The coming. The first coming of Jesus was silent. It still played out in the stars, though, didn't it? We have that great star, right? The Star of Bethlehem. But it was quiet. It was a silent night. We sing that at Christmas. And Jesus' birth came. Jesus lived his life. Jesus did his ministry. Jesus died upon a cross for our sins. Jesus conquered the grave and was risen. He is risen indeed. And then Jesus ascended into the heaven. That is the first coming. Played out over 33 years. Took thousands of years to get there. Played out from the moment, again, a display in the stars. The angelic beings come. But it was specific. And Jesus came as a servant. Jesus came to minister to us. Jesus came to be the spotless Lamb of God. And Jesus came to die on our behalf and raise from the dead and go back to the Father where he would rule. And then we get ready for the second parousia. We get ready for the second coming of Jesus. It's going to be totally different, you guys. What Jesus is saying is, you're going to know it's me. The signs will be there, from the cracking of the sky to the sun to the moon to the stars. It'll be earth shattering. There's going to be no doubt about it when I come back and I usher in the second coming. And here's what I want you to hear. Some people say the second coming is just one time. I think just like the first coming wasn't one time. Yes, his birth was one time, but then it played out over 33 years. I believe the second coming is the same type of way. We're going to have this rapture. We're going to have this tribulation. We're going to have the glorious appearing. We're going to go on. We're going to have the reign of Christ for 1,000 years. We're going to have everything come to a head, and then the final judgment. And we're going to have the new heaven, the new earth, the new Jerusalem, and usher in to our eternal existence forever with the Lord. That is the second coming. All that plays out. So the rapture, the return, and the reign. So here we finally move on now to verses 30 and 31. Again, I'm looking at this as duality. It could be describing one event, but it seems like there's possible duality. So what we see here, again, I'm confessing that I'm teaching from a pre-tribulational, premillennial perspective. But when we get here, the rapture and the glorious appearing, I believe, are separated by this great tribulation. So this parousia, the coming, is just like the first one. But it's different. And Jesus is describing that he will come in the clouds. Look right there in verse 30. He will come in the sky in the clouds, just like he left. If you go look in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 11. As I have ascended, I shall return. So as he ascended into the clouds, he will return with the clouds. He's coming in the clouds. And listen, when he comes back, this is what I'm calling the return. When he comes back, he will come back with great glory. Great glory is used here. The glorious appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a day it will be. And if the premillennial pre-trib view is correct, what will happen is those of us that have been raptured will be with the Lord. And then we will come back with the Lord in this glorious appearing upon the clouds. And we will be with the Son of Man, the Son of God, that will appear. Listen, in Daniel 7:13, I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like the Son of Man. He came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. The Ancient of Days, the Lord Jesus Christ, will come back on the clouds. Daniel, before he ever knew the Messiah, is prophesying of this. And then we see John play this out with us in the book of Revelation. Listen, chapter 1, verse 7. Behold, he's coming with the clouds. He's talking about Jesus. Behold, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. All the tribes of the earth will wail and mourn on account of him. Even so, amen. See, the cracking of the sky will be observed by all. But the glorious appearing also will be seen by all. He will come back on the clouds for all to see in his glorious appearing. When he returns this time, he will return as the glorious King, the glorious Judge, and he will come to rule, not to be the servant, not to be the Savior. He's already done that. He did that with the first coming. This time, he comes to reign and to rule and to return forevermore. Amen. This is how our Lord will come back. And even now, he will come, and then the last part of this, he will gather his elect. Now look, We'll be coming back with him. There'll be others that will be here on the earth, the tribulational saints and others. So whether this is the first time describing the rapture, or whether it's coming in the second, or whether it's a duality. In other words, he'll gather everybody together and then he'll gather them again. We don't know. All right, but Jesus is talking about a gathering that will take place here. A harvest of his people that will be like a compass to the north, to the east, to the south, and to the west. He describes it with an angel will have a trumpet call. And with the trumpet call, the Lord will return. It says he will gather his elect from the four winds. Again, an emphasis of the compass going to all extremes. Just like he cracked the sky when he came for the rapture. The glorious harvest of his glorious great reign will come with the north and the east and the south and the west. And everywhere to the ends of the earth. Listen, didn't Jesus tell us in verse 14 as he's unfolding this discourse? What's our obligation? Our obligation is to share the gospel to the ends of the earth. His gathering by his holy angels will be to go where the gospel has gone to the ends of the earth and gather up the elect, all that believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. What a glorious day that will be when he connects us and he gathers all of us together for his glorious appearing. All of the elect together. What an exciting time. But look, I've preached this from my heart. And I hope what it stirs up in you is one, to study the Word of God. But to know the one thing that's for sure. Jesus is saying he's coming. Whether there's a rapture and a glorious appearing or it's all one thing. Or whether we're here during the tribulation or we're not in the tribulation. Or it's after or if it's mid. All those things, they're important. I think we need to have a foundational understanding of them, and I think I've presented them in an eloquent, biblical, scriptural, logical way. But the one thing that's for sure is he's coming back. He's coming back. And when he comes back, he's coming back for us, his elect. He makes that clear. So he comes back for his elect. So if you're not part of the elect, here's the day. There's two responses. I want to cry out. The first thing is Jesus is coming. And I hope it's soon and very soon. We are going to see the King. And wouldn't that be awesome if Jesus came back right now, even while we're speaking? Soon and very soon. Are you a part of that? If you hear those words echoed out, if you hear that trumpet call, or if you hear that crack across the sky, don't miss it. Don't be the person that's sitting out there in creation that either ignorant to it or ignores it. Be the person now that's the elect. So if you're out there and you're not saved, say, I want to be a part of the elect. Go ahead, type it in below. I want to be a part of the elect. Write it in. Whether you're on YouTube or you're on Facebook, I want to be a part of the elect. I want you to be a part of the elect. How do you do that? Give your life to Jesus Christ right now. Bow your knee now to the Lord Jesus Christ. Confess him as Lord of lords and King of kings. Say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I believe you're my Savior. I accept you. Lord, I commit my life to you to live for you forevermore. Do that right now and give Jesus your life. I want to be the elect. I want to be the elect. Now for the rest of us, our time of response, listen, just say, I'm ready. Type it in there, I'm ready. I'm looking. I'm ready to jump. I'm ready for the rapture. I'm ready for the return. I'm ready for the reign. I'm ready for the Lord. Just type in, I'm ready for the Lord. I'm ready. Maranatha, come Lord, come quickly. So I want to be a part of the elect, or I'm ready. You know you're the elect. Whatever your response may be, may it challenge us. May it encourage us. May we know Jesus is coming back, and may we be ready for his return. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time to study your word. We thank you for this time to know for certain that you are coming back. And Lord, as we prepare and study and learn from this, Lord, you prepare us right now in this season of ministry that we're in, where we're doing digital worship. Prepare us for your return. Prepare us for the comeback. Almost like a little prelude, like we're not together and we're coming back as the people of God. You're going to gather us back together. And Lord, as that happens and that unfolds, may we just be enthused. May we be encouraged. May we be strengthened. May we be motivated like we've never been before. May we understand the essential aspects of what church really is about. And may it change the priorities of our church forevermore to be even more focused on going to the ends of the world with the gospel, so that when you come back and you gather some because of the work of what we have done here at Lexington Park Baptist Church. Lord, I pray for anyone that's responded that they want to be a part of the elect. Lord, I thank you for the one I shared earlier today as I prayed and I shared about how Ian has come to Christ and is going to be baptized. I thank you for Herman, that right before we had to take this COVID-19, I was able to sit down and lead him to Christ, and he's going to be baptized. And there's others that have reached out. God, I'm excited about your movement and what you're doing to bring people into the elect. And God, I'm excited, and we all should be, about what you're going to do with your elect here at Lexington Park as we serve you faithfully, continue to advance your gospel and your purposes here on earth. We give you all glory. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come very soon, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Now is my privilege, as I always get to stand up amongst the people of God. And I look forward to tonight when we get together at 7 p.m. being able to say this over you as we're outdoor worship, out in front of the cross of the church, out in front of the sign where we'll gather to worship tonight at 7 p.m. But it's been my honor to be able to say this over you digitally. And I look forward to tonight being able to say it over you personally. Now may the Lord God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift his countenance upon you, and may he give you his peace. Go in Jesus' name.